Welcome to Midwest Sportsnet. I'm Joey McWilliams. It is a privilege today to be joined by the head football coach of the Southeastern Savage Storm, Coach Tyler Fenwick, in his second season with the program. Coach, here we are in December now, but we're still talking Savage Storm football. And the reason for that is that you all will be playing in the Live United Bowl on Saturday against Emporia State. Let's start right there. Congratulations on a postseason opportunity for the program.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate it. It's one of those, I don't know, it's just one of those things where you kind of sit back and, you know, look at where we were 2 years ago and the direction that we're going and just the buy-in from our kids and the plan that we put together, that's all starting to kind of come together. And we still got some work to do, but at least, you know, we're headed in the right direction and it's showing up.
Coach, you know, you mentioned 2 years ago, and from our perspective, we talk about from one season to the next. And so from 2019, Southeastern was 1-10. Here in 2021, the very next season, even though 2020 was in there somewhere, we try not to remember all that, I'm sure. Right. 8-3. What a turnaround. And in light of that, then, you've gotten some postseason recognition as well. We want to talk about the team, but let's start with you. Coach of the Year in the Great American Conference. OklahomaSports.net has you the Coach of the Year in the state of Oklahoma in small colleges. Congratulations on that honor. I know it has been a big turnaround.
Yeah, it's been a big turnaround, but it's the Coach of the Year thing is great, and it's, you know, they put my name on it, but I mean, let's be real. I mean, I'm surrounded by some really good coaches, and have, you know, really good players in it, and that's what it takes. It's a program award. I think in anything that you do when there's an organization, I think that if you can surround yourself with good people that can and let them do their job, you're gonna have success. And we've got, you know, I'm fortunate to have some really smart football coaches that believe in what we're doing and believe in the vision that we've set and the plan that we put in place when we got here. That's half the battle right there. And then the second part of it is you better have good players. I'm fortunate to have all that. And I'll tell you, you know, the turnaround and what we've, you know, what we've done and where we're at right now, I think is a testament to the guys that have stuck it out. I think that in college football these days, it's so easy to transfer. It's so easy to look at, you know, the grass is greener somewhere else, and I'm going to go, you know, take my ball and go home and find another place. But our kids, that most of our kids on our roster, and in fact, I count, I think there's 31 of our kids that are in our two deep roster, depth chart, were here in 2019. I think there's five that are new, with some of the transfers that we brought in that are in our two deep. So, the point is, you know, these kids, you know, 31 of these kids that are in our two deep were, that went through the 1-10 season. They went through, COVID. They went through the ups and downs of not knowing what to expect, and they stuck it out rather than saying, you know what, 1-10, I don't want to be a part of this. I want to go somewhere else. And they gave us a chance to pull it together and lead them and put them in position to be successful and develop them and all the things that goes into winning. And a lot of those guys will be back next year, which, you know, there's another step that we're going to have to take. But I think it's just a testament to our kids just being able to stick it out. And I think it shows that, it's not always the best thing to just, pick up and go somewhere else and put yourself in the transfer portal. Because it's easy to do that now. I mean, it's one of those things that, kids, they see it on social media, and I'm going to go in the transfer portal and this and that, and then, you know, what's next? And rather than just being in a good place, you know, coached by good coaches and a part of a university that supports them and all that stuff. So it's good to see that we were able to overcome all that and stay together.
We're speaking now with Coach Tyler Fenwick here on the Summit on Midwest Sportsnet and Midwest Sportsnet, a channel where we talk about small college sports and more throughout the Midwest and beyond. Please do consider subscribing. Coach, you know, you were talking about some of those players. Let's mention a few of them really quickly. A number of postseason honors, many Savage Dorm players making conference honors as well as getting individual recognition, like Malik Hall, who is the GAC Defensive Player of the Year, 12 tackles for loss, 6 sacks, a couple of forced fumbles, recovered one of those as well. I know he's been a big part of your defense.
Yeah, I mean, huge part of our defense. And I think, you know, when it comes down to it, his athletic ability, his, you know, just his quickness, his strength, and the fact that we put him in different places, you know, playing outside linebacker and playing defensive end and just, you know, put him in position to rush the passer and drop and do a lot of things with him. I think, you know, from a opponent standpoint, you know, they have to know where he's at all times. I think they have to be able to make sure that they, you know, if he's going to come off the edge, you know, trying to maybe help or whatever. So I think it's a respect of where is Malik Hall, where's number 22 on the field, and let's make sure that we handle him and take care of him. And you know, there's times where they had to double him and you know, just from a game plan standpoint. So yeah, I mean, he's an incredible football player. And honestly, I mean, he's an incredible human being. I mean, he's just a great kid. He's always got a smile on his face. He's always got a great attitude. He's always, you know, 110% in the weight room, takes care of his body, all the things that you're looking for. So well-deserved.
Coach, and you're talking about the players that are well-deserving of honors. Sometimes the offensive line may not get the recognition that it probably does deserve. And with an offense like what you all have had this season, of course, Dalton Hatley leading the way at quarterback position, you got a couple of players that got first-team recognition from that offensive line, and that includes James Walker and Caleb Weatherford, that have gone a long way toward making sure that you can put those points on the board and rack up those yards. And I know that's a big deal as well.
Yeah, that was a big deal. And that was, you know, I think, you, again, looking back at 2019, we had zero all-conference offensive linemen. And, you know, the development and the recruiting and, you know, what Coach Throckmorton, our offensive line coach, has done to develop those guys and get those guys to play together. Is incredible. And, you know, to have 4 out of the 5 to get all some kind of all conference honors is really a testament to those guys and to Coach Throckmorton for getting that done. But, you know, it's definitely something that we needed. I think we cut our sack totals down, you know, way down, probably in half. You know, we're running the ball better, we're more balanced, and we're just playing more physical and a lot less assignment errors, you know. And so they're playing together well. And I think, you know, that leads to, you know, Hatley sitting in the pocket and having more trust in those guys in protection and having a cleaner pocket.
And he's had a great season as well, too. I know we can talk about all of those players and I know that you're appreciative of them. Let me ask you then to look ahead just a little bit now as we look towards Saturday, and you're going to be in the Live United Bowl, a Division II bowl game. There are a limited number of those throughout the country, and so there's an honor to that as well. 8-3 coming in, taking on Emporia State, 6-5 out of the MIAA. Interestingly enough, a team that you have seen most recently, even though neither program has played the other before in school history, you all had an opportunity to get to scrimmage and have a kind of a joint practice with Emporia State back in the spring. Of course, all the stuff in 2020 with COVID, there wasn't a lot of Division II football being played, and yet you guys got to get together you know, put on different colored uniforms and go against one another for a little bit. Talk about that.
Yeah, it was good to see. You know, I had reached out to Coach Higgins up at Emporia. Probably, you know, over the break, the holiday break. And it just, you know, it was kind of one of those, hey, we're looking into this, you know, would you be interested? And they didn't know what was going on. And then, you know, at some point, I think we had our 2 scrimmages already scheduled. And so he contacted me and said, hey, do you want to do this? And, you know, it's like, yeah, that'd be great. Let's do it. And I think it'd be a good opponent, you know, get some good work. And I think the other thing too would be, you know, just to be on the same page as far as wanting to develop our, our depth and make sure that we play guys, you know, and get on the same script as far as, you know, when you're going to play your starters and how much you're going to play your starters and when you're going to play your backups and, you know, that. So it was a good, it was a really good day, and we got a lot of good work in. And I think it made both of us, you know, better and more prepared for the 21 season. But it is unique that, you know, with all that, now we get to match up again and play a game for real, you know, where you're going to play your starters, you know, the whole game and you know, get after it. It was, you know, it was one of those things where, you know, you look back, you go, okay, now, you know, we get to look back and see, okay, what was good and what was bad and kind of study that. And they do some really good stuff. I mean, they make it difficult to prepare and they make it difficult to see what's going on. They, you know, on both sides of the ball, you know, they're going to spread you out and throw it around and get the ball out of the quarterback's hands quickly and play with tempo. And so you got to be, you know, defensively, you got to be ready to line up and get ready for the next play. And then, you know, their defense, you know, they do some good stuff with their coverages and all their different safety looks and pressure looks and all that stuff. So they make it, it's unorthodox, you know, it's not something you prepare for every week. And fortunately, you know, we've had the opportunity to scrimmage them and see it and then have the extra time, you know, these last couple of weeks to kind of study it a little bit more.
It'll be the first official meeting for each team in program history against the other one. And Coach, then as you mentioned, and we'll wrap up our time with that. They do. It's an interesting, it's a solid program coming out of a solid conference, and what Coach Higgins has been able to do in his time there, and specifically in the last decade or so, has been impressive. Then you talked about them. What does it take for Southeastern then to come away with a victory on Saturday?
Yeah, I mean, I think just like every week, I mean, you got to make sure that you're, you know, valuing the football, making sure that you know, that we don't turn it over. You know, when we played them in the scrimmage, I mean, we threw a bunch of interceptions and turned it over. And you know, so we've got to make sure we eliminate that stuff offensively. And then, you know, defensively, I think that, you know, the key is to make sure that we don't give up the big play, because they'll play with tempo and they'll get you out of alignment and they'll get you, you know, all of a sudden you bust a coverage and they hit a big play down the seam or down the sideline or whatever. And, you know, or, and so you got to be on it. You got to be ready for every snap. And, you know, again, I think, you know, they do a really good job. They're very well coached. And so we've got to match that. And, you know, it's one of those things. I mean, they're it's an MIAA football team that, you know, is, I don't think an MIAA team has lost in the Live United Bowl yet. So that's, it'll definitely be a big challenge for us. And, you know, I know our kids are excited for the game. They're excited to play an extra game, you know, a 12th game. And it, you know, they've had really good practices because they love to play and love to be on the field. So, definitely looking forward to it, and I think it's going to be a good game.
All right. Well, Southeastern playing in its first postseason opportunity since 2014 and heading back to the Live United Bowl in Texarkana, Arkansas, and that's coming up on Saturday. Southeastern and Emporia State in that. Coach Tyler Fenwick, thank you so much for taking time with us today here on the Summit. Success to you all, and we look forward to getting to watch that game on Saturday. It should be a lot of fun.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thanks, Joey.